Around the same time, we have Harvey Weinstein, we have Jeffrey Epstein, we have all these different revelations, the Me Too movement, all this is going on at the same time, and I start rethinking this and saying to myself, you know, the sexual revolution really is implicated here because it provides cover for the predators. It's an ideological smokescreen, an ideological cover that allows predation to go on. Good morning. I'm Dr. Morse, and my talk is called Childhood Sexual Abuse, Ending It and Healing It. I'd like to begin this presentation with a statement that may be shocking to some of you. You will recognize it as true the minute I say it. However, you may not have put it in quite these blunt of terms. The global ruling class likes the sexual revolution. They like it just the way it is. The global ruling class likes the sexual revolution, including pedophilia. We now know this to be true. There are enough highly placed, globally highly placed people who have been found guilty of horrible, horrible, massive crimes against children and vulnerable women. And we don't even know the tip of the iceberg, I'm sure of that, okay? But we know enough to be sure that this is going on, and we're operating in something of a setting of incomplete information, but we know enough to draw this inference. So before I say anything more about the subject of childhood sexual abuse, I would like to say something to any victims or survivors who may be listening, because I know, they get in touch with me, that there are a lot of people who have been touched by this type of experience. The first thing I want to say is I know that what happened to you is real, and I know that post-traumatic stress disorder is a real thing. Last year, we had a survivor give our keynote speech, and by the time she was done with that speech, she could barely walk. And you can see it last year, if you look at the banquet from the 2019 summit, you'll see Moira Graylin Pete, and you'll see her give this incredible speech. And when it was over, she literally had to be helped from the out and through the parking lot to get into her car. PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, is a real thing. So if you are watching, especially if you're watching online after the fact, and you get upset, just pause and do whatever you need to do to take care of yourself. I want you to know that I know that that's going on. Now a word to everybody else about this topic. Listen, y'all, PTSD is a real thing. Triggering is a real thing. Trivializing sexual abuse is wrong. It is wrong to bring up false accusations in order to score points against your political or ecclesial opponents. This is wrong. It is trivializing this very traumatic event and causing unknowable amounts of harm to people who have actually been abused. Trivializing triggering is also dead wrong. For people to be going around saying, I'm triggered by some political statement, that is a grave disservice to everybody who actually is suffering from PTSD and is being triggered by all kinds of things that you and I can't even imagine. So my all the politicization of these issues that are going on, I'm telling you, knock it off, all of you. Left, right, center, I don't care. Knock it off. It's not fair to the people who've really been through the mill. Now, I want to start by showing you of some instances of how I am convinced that the global ruling class really truly does like the sexual revolution just as it is. Up on the screen now, I have an image of this book called Making Hate Pay. This is a book about the Southern Poverty Law Center, recently came out. And the Southern Poverty Law Center, as you may know, is one of the most wealthy and influential race-baiting organizations in America. This organization, Southern Poverty Law Center, has $250 million in offshore bank accounts, okay? So when Mr. O'Neill, the author of this book, Tyler O'Neill, says, making hate pay, yeah, they're making it work for them, all right? Now, I read this book because the Ruth Institute's mentioned in this book, and I'm reading this book and I'm reading along, and I see in here the founder of the Southern Poverty Law Center, Morris Dees, had multiple instances of sexual harassment within the staff of his organization. The climate of sexual harassment is a real thing that people in there talk about. And what struck me as I'm reading this is, gee, this sounds familiar. There's a kind of grooming process going on inside the organization so that everybody knows and nobody tells. I thought, gee, that's interesting. Where have I heard that before? You know, so that's instance number one. And I interviewed Mr. O'Neill on the, there's an episode of the Dr. J Show with Tyler O'Neill. Okay, next. The same phenomenon is also at work in the public school system, where there are teachers and administrators who are causing all kinds of problems. Everybody knows, nobody will do anything about it. And I, again, was asked to read a book about it, and I go, wow, where have I heard this before? The title of this book is called Passing the Trash. So what do you think she thinks is going on in the public schools? They're moving people around. And nobody's tracking the fact that this person is a problem, was a problem. So this pattern seems to be kind of real. Now there's another organization that some of you have heard of, which is the United Nations. Now this book, The Invincible Family, which is just about to come out, I think like tomorrow is its publication date or something like that. We also have an interview with the author of this book on the Dr. J Show podcast. Part of what she does in this book is she talks about the United Nations and their ideology and the different things they're doing. But in passing, you find out there are big-time sex scandals in the United Nations. And what you find out is that there are peacekeeping troops around the world who are having sex for food deals with little kids in refugee camps. How does that make you feel? Right? That means revolting. And so people, and again, people know about it. Nothing's getting done about it. So, but the case of the United Nations is even more egregious when you look at some of the people who are high up in that organization. You realize not only are they doing these things, but they are also promoting an ideology that enables them to do these things and which disarms the victims. So this particular person I have up here is a highly placed person within the United Nations named Peter Newell. He is one of the co-authors of a document that the United Nations puts out called the Implementation Handbook for the Convention on the Rights of the Child. So this guy's job is to tell people how to protect the rights of children, and he has been implicated in sex crimes. Okay, how do you like that? So on this slide, you can see his name. His name is right on the cover of that document. Now, we have, many of us here in the room and online are Catholic, and we're freaked out over Catholic clergy sexual abuse. We're upset about it. And we know a lot of other churches have problems. So this is a very widespread phenomenon. That's what I'm getting at, that many, many institutions have problems of sexual abuse of minors. Now, why am I bringing up all these other people? It's certainly not so I can make excuses for the Catholic Church, because sometimes you'll hear people say, well, everybody else is doing as bad as we are. I don't want to hear that. That's not the point, okay? The point is, who's going to do something about it? Do you really think the United Nations is going to do something about it? Do you really think the public school system is going to do something about it? Southern Poverty Law Center is going to all of a sudden do something about it? I don't think so. These are all people who one way or another are championing the rights of people to have whatever sex lives they want. That's what we're dealing with. So if you look at this guy, back to Peter Newell, when they talk about children's rights, this Convention for the Rights of the Child, this Handbook for the Rights of the Child, when they talk about it, what they mean is the rights of children to have any sex they want without their parents knowing it. That's what the United Nations means by children's rights. When the Ruth Institute talks about children's rights, what we mean is the right of the child to know their parents, to know their identity, to have a relationship with their parents. That's what we think children's rights are. We think that's the birthright of every person. Thank you. Thank you. What the UN thinks is that is that children have the right to have sex with anybody they want, anytime they want, without their parents knowing. Now, to me, this sounds like you're grooming people. You're getting people ready to be victims by talking to them like that, by creating this culture where this is considered acceptable. So I'm now going to speak directly to my fellow Catholics, because I know there are a lot of you here. I also know that those of you who are not Catholic who are participating in this, many of you have the similar kinds of concerns about your own denominations and churches, because there's just a lot of this going on. This is an image of our late, great St. John Paul II speaking to a massive crowd in Phoenix, okay? Do you miss the feeling that we were part of something big? He always made us feel like we were part of something big and beautiful and significant. I mean, he brought down the Berlin Wall, you know? Come on, we love that guy. And you miss that feeling. This feels cruddy that we have to deal with clergy sex abuse instead of this other stuff. So by the end of this talk, we will deal with this. We're going to deal with that feeling that we have. But I do want to say, in my opinion, as Catholics, we have no right to leave the church over this. The deposit of the faith was handed to us when we were children. It was given to us pretty much intact, and we have an obligation to pass it on to the next generation in as good a shape as we got it, or hopefully better. And I'm putting images up here that will be familiar to Catholics. You know who all these people are. We've got St. Peter Claver, who's the patron saint of this diocese, Thomas Aquinas, Thomas More, who lost his head over the whole thing, St. Teresa of Avila, this beautiful statue that is in Rome, and then St. Catherine Drexel, who founded schools all over the place in the American South. She spent her fortune starting schools, one of which we have here in Lake Charles, and which had to be closed because there weren't enough children and there weren't enough community support. That school, started by Catherine Drexel, closed in the last 10 years here in Lake Charles. Anyway, so the point is, these other organizations, none of the other corrupted organizations has the resources to deal with childhood sexual abuse the way we have as Catholics. First of all, we have a coherent theory to counter the sexual revolutionary ideology. Nobody in Hollywood can compete with that, okay? Secondly, we have a history of practices that would be helpful if we would just do what we are supposed to do, what we've been taught by, you know, a couple thousand years of ascetic practice. If we just did what we already knew we were supposed to do, it would be really helpful. And finally, and most importantly to everybody watching, in the Catholic Church and in other churches, we have a core group of people who love the institution enough to want to reform it. Yes, we have enough people who love it and who want to reform it, and nobody else can say that. All right, so if this is going to get dealt with, it's going to be dealt with by us. So quite the opposite of saying, well, everybody else is doing it, so we don't have to worry about it. Opposite. The opposite is true. Because everyone else is doing it, we have a special obligation to get out there and deal with it, because nobody else will. And if we don't get it together, all those other people are going to go down the tubes too. So that's the idea. Now, what I am going to say, just in the interest of full disclosure and also to put our non-Catholic friends at ease, that I'm not going to ask you to worship statues or anything like that. There's a 500-year-old misunderstanding. What we are advocating and you can find it in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, okay? You can find it in there. Whatever it says in here about the fourth commandment, the fifth commandment, and the sixth commandment, we number them different than y'all. The fourth, fifth, and sixth commandment and the sacrament of matrimony, if you hear some knucklehead in a Roman collar saying something and you go, that doesn't sound right, this is where you look to find out if it's right, okay? And because there are a lot of people spreading out misinformation, saying they're Catholic, and they're putting out stuff that isn't really true. So my thought is this. We have a choice between the Catechism of the Catholic Church or the UN document on implementing the rights of the child. Okay, which document do you think we should take our chances with here? All right, we got corrupt people all over the place, but this is where we're going to stand. This is what we're going to stand on, and it's the truth. It's the doctrine, it's the principles, not necessarily the people. Because we know people can disappoint you, even good people will disappoint you. But we also know that all of our institutions have corruption in them, so you can't necessarily trust somebody with the right badge on, you know? So this is the lodestar in that way. Now, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about calls to action, because calls to action, we're going to do something. We're here to do something, okay? And in marketing, call to action has a very specific sort of meaning. Okay, this is an image of a advertisement that is around here in this town. Okay, This Mr. Little Caesars here is very clear what he wants you to do. Turn left now, okay? And you look at this thing and you go, pizza. Oh, yeah, pizza. Because you know exactly what you're going to get because you see the Little Caesar guy and everything. So there's no dithering here. There's no, you know, if you're hungry, you might want to go over there. You know, no, turn left now, okay? So when you see the Ruth Institute logo, I want you to be just as triggered by us as you are by the Little Caesars guy. And what can you expect when you see Ruth Institute? You can expect two things. Number one, these people know what they're talking about. Okay? Do we know what we're talking, y'all who were here yesterday, do we know what we're talking about? Yeah, we know what we're talking about. That's that, you know, so. And secondly, you're going to think that Dr. Morse gives me something to do. She's about to tell me to do something. So if you don't want to do anything, get lost. Get lost now. Wait, that's not in the script. I shouldn't have said that. Anyway, and it's going to be fun, but we're going to get something done. And it might be slightly nerdy. That is the nerd bird that we have here in Louisiana, but that's another whole story. All right, now, turn left. Do we really want to go left? Oh my gosh, Little Caesars is over there, but left is bad news. I want to say we are neither left nor right, and I think this is an important point. Those of you who've been involved in partisan politics will know that, yes, all of our enemies are concentrated in one party, but within the party that's supposed to be our party, there are a lot of bad actors over there, too. So I think it's better for us to not identify too closely with left or right and just say we are Orthodox believers. We believe in the traditional Christian sexual morality and let it go at that rather than adopt the labels that are political. We're the faithful remnants of Orthodoxy. So, call to action number one, those of you online, sign up now for the Ruth Institute electronic newsletter. We send it out by email. And one thing we like about that is that the tech overlords cannot shut us down on our own email list. They could shut us down on Facebook, they could shut us down on YouTube, but we can still send you email, so you definitely want to sign up. So my research showed me that the sexual revolution is beyond left and right. It is the entire global ruling class that likes the sexual revolution just the way it is. So there are two things we have to insist on. We want justice in the clergy sexual abuse situation. This is what we want. And justice, and second, we must insist that the church's teachings are correct and still have always been correct all along. We have a lot of people out in Catholic circles saying, if only you would allow the priest to get married, nothing bad would happen. If only you would allow the priest, if only you would stop being so mean to homosexuals, everything would be solved. Those things are not true. And we stand on the truth that that everyone should be in command of themselves, everyone should be in command of their sexual powers, and that's what the catechism says to everybody, no matter what your state of life might be, okay? So we're defending the teaching, and we're also saying we want justice for the abusers. Now, justice means punish the guilty, protect the innocent, and restore the victims. That's what is involved with justice in this particular context. Because even here, we've got tons of allegations that are true and where we have genuine perpetrators and they have to be dealt with. But we also have some false allegations that are being made for, you know, a whole variety of reasons. So we don't want people just being thrown under the bus too. So it's hard, but that's what needs to happen. Now, I'm going to say a few words about the sexual revolution so that you can understand where we're coming from here. What is the sexual revolution, how it operates, and how we can move to something better. So the basic idea of the sexual revolution is that a good and decent society should do everything possible to separate sex from babies. And we call this the contraceptive ideology, that you should separate sex from babies. Secondly, the sexual revolution says that a good and decent society should separate sex and babies both from marriage, and we call that the divorce ideology. And then finally, the sexual revolution says that we should wipe out all differences between men and women. The differences of the body are not significant, and so we should wipe out all the differences between men and women, except the ones people specifically want to bear, in fact, if they want to change who they are. And that we call the gender ideology. Now, I have 45-minute talks on each one of those three topics, so I'm not going to go into too much detail about it now, but these other talks are available, too, if you're interested. Now, There's the core problem with the sexual revolution. If you want to separate sex from babies and you think this is a high moral duty, there's a little problem, which is that sex actually does make babies. Don't look at me like that. You guys know that's true, right? All right, thank you very much. We always have to check. All right. Now, separating both sex and babies from marriage disrupts the child's relationship with one or both parents, and that's called what we call the divorce ideology. Children actually do need their parents. Yeah, they're resilient, but they're not that resilient. Kids need their parents. And finally, saying you're going to wipe out all the differences between men and women, that comes up against the problem that men and women actually are different. So what we have is a massive, highly funded global ideology trying to promote three things that are false and which cannot be done. So we can say that the sexual revolution is irrational, it is impossible, and it cannot stand on its own two feet. Therefore, it requires massive amounts of force from the government and social pressures, and it also requires propaganda, lots and lots of propaganda. It is a totalitarian ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with. That's the sexual revolution. So, secondly, I want to point out to you how much propaganda there is out there for the sexual revolution. A lot of you, now that you start thinking about it, you will see that it's all over the place. But I want to point out just a couple of particularly noteworthy and egregious examples. A few years ago, the New York Times ran a story called Why Women Had Better Sex Under Socialism. One wonders how they know such a thing. But anyway, this is a, you know, a headline in the New York Times, Why Women Had Better Sex Under Socialism. And if you look at this photo, we have this cheerful, well-fed, healthy-looking Russian peasant girl. You know, obviously she's having better sex, and she's obviously also well-fed and so on. And I had to wonder to myself, well, gee, New York Times, since they have a history of covering up for the massive famine in the Ukraine, this looks like a Soviet propaganda piece saying, oh, we're all okay, okay? Now, I don't know that. I don't know where they got that photo, but it looks like it could have come out of their archives from the 30s, you know, I'm just saying. All right, now, here's another egregious example of propaganda. This film was made by the Disney Studios in 1968. It's called The Family Planning Story, and it features Donald Duck explaining to everyone why it's okay to use family planning. And it's very discreet. It's not like anything that you would see made today. You know, it's not explicit or anything like that. It's very discreet. But it's very subtle, and it's very well done propaganda saying you're uncool if you don't use family planning, and you are cool if you do, and you will be rich, and if you have too many kids, you're going to all be starving and scraggly looking and so on. It's very clear, and it was financed by, if you can see it there, the Population Council. That it was the organization of John D. Rockefeller III, who was very big on promoting population control back in the day. So these are particular examples of propaganda that are older, but they're still out there. And if once you start looking around, you're going to see propaganda all over the place. The next point that I want to really insist on, because it's immediately relevant to the question of childhood sexual abuse, is the business of hiding and shaming the victims, silencing the victims, telling them they don't matter. Now, we have a pamphlet that we created called Victims and Survivors of the Sexual Revolution. I think we still have a few more of these in this format. It's going to be redesigned. But what we tried to do was to say to ourselves, well, how many people have been harmed by the sexual revolution? Who has been harmed by the sexual revolution? We came up with all these topics. And there's also a pamphlet called How Many? And it's called Counting the Casualties of the Sexual Revolution. And, you know, we figured out that the children of divorce, at the time we did this pamphlet, that there were probably 45 million people of all ages who had survived their parents' divorce. And these are old numbers, so it's surely more by now. Those who are standing by watching also count as victims in a way, because I know many of the people who follow the Ruth Institute are watching their kids in a slow motion train wreck and can't figure out what to do about it, and that certainly counts as a suffering by all means. Now, one thing you'll notice if you look at the Ruth Institute's material, you will not see sexual abuse victims on either of these two pamphlets. And I want to tell you why you won't. When we devised this concept and we thought about it in 2013, I thought about it. I thought, well, you know, does that count? Should we include that? And I, what I said to myself was, you know, there's always been a certain amount of childhood sexual abuse. It's probably not fair to blame that on the sexual revolution. And what I was feeling was, this is icky and I don't want to deal with it, so I'll just stick with the topics I know something about and I'm comfortable with. That's enough for one person. I'm going to do that. I'll just not look over there too much. Then the whole clergy sexual abuse thing popped up in 2018. Of course, it had been there all along. I just wasn't looking, right? And then around the same time, we have Harvey Weinstein, we have Jeffrey Epstein, we have all these different revelations, the Me Too movement, all this is going on at the same time, and I start rethinking this and saying to myself, you know, the sexual revolution really is implicated here because it provides cover for the predators. It's an ideological smokescreen, an ideological cover that allows predation to go on, because after all, you were born this way. I'm your destiny, a man could be saying to a prospective young man partner. You want to be sex positive, don't you? You don't want to be all hung up, do you? I'll give you nice things. This is the kind of line that can come from a sex predator to somebody of male or female, and is we frequently hear this, the kind of grooming that is done of the victims. But it's also the case that there's a kind of grooming of the whole community that is going on, because we're all thinking to ourselves, well, it's their business. It's not our business, right? And many times people overlook things that they shouldn't overlook. People are afraid to say something because we're all supposed to be sex positive. Okay, and in the background, remember the United Nations promoting this idea that the rights of the child include the rights to have sex with whoever they want to. Okay, so there's a kind of culture-wide grooming that is going on to make it seem like it's okay, that breaks down the resistance of the victims, it disarms the victims, and it enables and emboldens the predators. That's how the sexual revolution is implicated in it's childhood sexual abuse, and that's why the Ruth Institute is talking about it and why we think it needs to be talked about. So now I'm going to say a bit about combating the sexual revolution, and this is specifically for the activist part of what we're doing. It's my belief that everybody can do something, and so we want to talk about discerning your gifts and talents and where you might fit into the things, and then secondly, action. What are you going to do? Now, I have to say that this is kind of a constant problem for us, and you're going to face a version of this problem, which is, what is your area of expertise? What can you get done? In order to deal with childhood sexual abuse and to really deal with it, there are a lot of elements that need to be in play. I don't know anybody who can do all of them, okay? Nobody can do them all. So the Ruth Institute, full disclosure, we do not do law enforcement. Right, that's not who we are. We don't do investigative journalism. We're not going to track down somebody who, you know, we heard an allegation, blah, 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 we're going to get to the bottom of it. No, that's not what we do. We don't take cases. We're not lawyers. We don't do litigation. We don't go out and lobby for policy changes in the government. And we're not lobbying for reforms of church structures or ecclesial structures and policies or canon law or anything like that. We don't do any of that. We also don't do personal counseling. So all these things we don't do. But that's important because it keeps you from drifting off your mission. Our mission is to present the information, to educate the public about what's going on, and then people can use that information in whatever their sphere might be. So if you have a vocation to any of these things that are up on the screen, I expect you to use your gifts and talents and position to the best of your ability, but I'm not going to tell you how to do it because I don't know, okay? But we'll give you some information that hopefully will help. This is one of my favorite quotes from the late, great John Paul II. He said, "It is not permissible for anyone to be idle." I hope you will take that seriously, that by the end of the day, you will have something that you can do that will be helpful. So in my opinion, there are three elements that must be in place to help the victims and survivors of clergy sex abuse, of childhood sex abuse of any kind. First of all, we have to dedicate ourselves to supporting the victims. And I'm going to say more about each one of these three things, but we're going to support the victims. Secondly, we're going to educate ourselves and others about the truth of Christian sexual morality. And thirdly, we have to advocate. So all of those three pieces have to be done by somebody. They won't all be done by you, but they all have to get done. So supporting the victims and survivors, I want you to pay particular attention here. I want you to imagine all these allegations that you've heard about, let's just take a specific case, clergy sexual abuse in the Catholic Church. Imagine how different that climate would have been if the victims knew they could tell somebody and people would listen. That whole business would not have gone on the way it did, as long as it did, if the victims knew that there were lay people, people in the community who would say, whoa, we got to, thank you for telling me, let's deal with it, and so on. That we're not demanding that the bishops do anything. We're saying if we do something, the bishops will behave differently. The priests will behave differently. If we behave differently, that's going to force them to behave differently. Think about the church secretaries, the housekeepers, the teachers, the people who saw stuff going on and didn't say anything. In fact, one of the most important set of revelations that's going on right now is in Buffalo. And the way that Buffalo thing came down was there was the church secretary, the woman who was doing handling all the correspondence for the bishop, is looking at the documents and talking to the people and going, this doesn't add up, and she blew the whistle on them. So if you had more people doing that more of the time, this thing would be, it would look very different, let's put it that way. Okay, and think about all the people who enabled Jeffrey Epstein. You can't tell me the hotels that he used and the airline pilots that he hired and all these other people. You can't tell me none of them knew, okay? So supporting the victim involves this part, to say to them, we believe you. We believe you. And then friendship. Offer people friendship. And because I'll tell you, that feeling I had, the reason I confessed it, that feeling I had, I think, is very common. This is icky. I don't want to deal with it. Now, if you're the victim of sex abuse and you start to say something and you go like this, this is icky, I don't want to deal with it, you're not helping at that point, right? That's becoming a problem. But now that I've put this thought in your mind, some of you who think you're ordinary people are going to be really good at healing friendship. Some of you have a charism to this, where you can reach out to other people, involve them in ordinary activities of daily life, and just spend time with them, hang out with them, include them, don't shun them. And by building up that friendship, you are supporting them. You don't have to be talking about it all 100% of the time, right? Because that's artificial and stupid, and you know that would just get weird fast. But to make sure that you do not shun people, make sure that you include people, make sure you're willing to talk and to listen. Some of you will have this very unique and special and important vocation. Now, let's talk about educating. Some of you are going to be really good at this. We need to proclaim the truth about marriage, family, human sexuality, and sexual conduct. Because, as Catholics, we know none of this would have happened if people were actually doing what the church tells them to do. Right? Obviously, none of this would have happened. So we need to know what it is. The world needs to hear Jesus' teaching on marriage, family, and human sexuality. The world needs that now more than ever. And our non-Catholic brothers and sisters who collaborate with us, they are involved with it because they agree with that. They believe in that. And so this is something we can all do together. And as Catholics, we know that we can't count on the clergy to proclaim these truths. Now we know why we can't count on them, because they're all corrupted, not all, because many of them have their own issues. Let's just put it that way. Let's not get hysterical here. We all know what we're talking about. Okay, so ways, specific things that you can do, okay, to proclaim the truth about marriage, family, and human sexuality. You need to educate yourself by personal reading, and we have a ton of material for you. That will benefit. So you can do that, and you can start reading groups. Now, right now during COVID, nobody's supposed to meet together. Okay, you get three or four or five people together, and you start reading through some of these materials and educating yourself and building a little group of people who are committed. This is why we promoted the watch party concept for this very conference. We wanted, if anybody wanted to do it, if anybody was able to do it, we wanted people out there getting a small group of people together to watch this summit, to send in questions, to feel like they're part of it, and also, of course, to eat the jambalaya that we sent them in the welcome package. Okay. You can also put on, once we're allowed to do this again, you can put on programs in public. You should go to your local public library and say, we'd like to have a program about Christian sexual morality at your library, and see what they do. And whether they let you do it or don't let you do it, this has elements of advocating as well as educating, but it's something to think about, okay? And you can also educate people online if you're involved in social media. Here's another very specific thing that you can do that's educational in nature. There is a body of stuff out there that calls itself gay theology, or doesn't maybe not even call itself anything, but there are a number of people across the Christian denominations who are saying that Jesus never said anything about homosexuality, so it's okay. And they have a whole line of things that they have to say. We have the person whose image I have here, Father James Martin, is kind of an archetype for that in the Catholic Church, but there are comparable guys in throughout the evangelical world as well. So here's our thought process. Whenever you see one of these guys or somebody quoting one of these guys, educate your followers by saying, you know, there is an alternative way to handle the feelings of same-sex attraction. Let me tell you about my friend Hudson Biblow. Let me tell you about my friend Elizabeth Wanning. And on the Ruth Institute page, we have something that we call the Cloud of Witnesses Project, and we are looking for more people to be in it. Luis, I don't think we have you in there yet, but we're going to get you in there. We're always looking for more people to add to it, but what you can do is whenever somebody presents Father James Martin, you present Mr. Doug Mainwaring, or whatever it is, whoever you want to put up there, okay? So this is your call to action number two, and everybody can do this. If you have a social media account and somebody pops up on your feed saying, but Father Martin says, you say, oh, that's nice. Don't argue with them. Don't get into a back and forth argument with them. Just post, here's an alternative view. You should really look at this. Okay. So the third call to action is send us more witnesses, okay? If you encounter people or there are other websites, I haven't collected them all is the point, and I need y'all's help to send me these people. These two people, Charlene Cothran and Doug Mainwaring, we both have Dr. J Show episodes that are interviews with them. So a little bit bigger project that I want to call to your attention is that the Ruth Institute will assist you in bringing one of these people to your community if you need a speaker who is defending Catholic teaching or Christian teaching, and you got some big celebrity pro-gay theology guy coming to town, you can present your own event. You know, you don't have to go and pick at the guy. You can just say, we're having an event next week. Why don't y'all come? And it turns out that we kind of floated this idea out there, and somebody picked it up and ran with it, and there's a person who did that in this very room. So you can talk to him about that. But that's a little bit bigger project, but some of you have the capacity to do that, and we all need to be stretching what we consider acceptable and possible for us. Now, we need to advocate for better policies. The third step is advocate, and some of you have that gift, and it is a gift. You don't want to be sitting around a coffee shop holding hands with somebody. You want to be out there fighting. Okay, we got something for you. Okay, advocate. Advocate on two different levels. I'm going to say something, advocate for better church policies. And you can advocate for better public policies, whatever it is. But pick something and go for it. So in the Catholic Church, for example, you might say, Father, what we'd really like is for you to shut down the face-to-face confessionals. Now, why do I need to say that? Okay, a lot of times I say this and people don't know what I'm talking about. In the Catholic Church, you're supposed to have a screen between yourself and your confessor. There's supposed to be physical distance and moral distance between you. And after Vatican II, a face-to-face confession was permitted, and some terrible things have happened in the context of that space that should be sacred, okay? So if you just go to your pastor and say, you know, Father, I think it'd be a good idea to get rid of the face-to-face confessional. Could we get the screen back and stuff? And now you're just bugging him. You're just bugging him. It doesn't look like it's about clergy sex abuse, but it is about clergy sex abuse. You're just bugging him. Sorry, guys, if you're watching. You need to be bugged. Okay. Secondly, more time for confession. Father, it's only available by appointment? Come on, man. Come on. We got a lot of sin going on here. I'll come. I'll be there every week, I promise. You know, that kind of thing. You can ask your pastor or the principal of your local public school. You know, we really want theology of the body to be taught in our school. We don't know what this stuff is you're teaching, but theology of the body, that's what we want. And there are a number of good curriculums for all ages that use John Paul's theology of the body. So you go in and you advocate for that to your pastor or your school or your school principal. And Father, by all means, we need to get rid of this sex ed that you got from CECAS or Planned Parenthood or somebody. That's really got to get out of the Catholic school, okay? Okay, Father, thanks, great. All right, and you also want to stick up for good priests. You want to help them when they're trying to do the right thing and they're encountering resistance within the church. I think, in my opinion, we need a systematic plan for helping priests who are in some kind of hot water with their bishop over doing the right thing. So I'm just going to put that out there. Now, not everybody's Catholic. Not all the problems are Catholic Church policy problems. So advocating for better public policies, which, of course, anyone can do. Lobby the school board. We're going to hear more about that later today. Get rid of this exploitative sexual education that is out there. Combat the drag queen story hour in your community. And you can pressure advertisers. We could use a systematic plan for pressuring advertisers who are in one way or another promoting the sexual revolution. And finally, I've mentioned this several times over this weekend. I think we cannot say this enough. Every profession has been corrupted by the sexual revolution, and you need to retake your profession. Do whatever's necessary to take it. So whatever you choose to do, whether you're going to support the victims, educate the public, or advocate for better public policies, you are part of the solution. All of these things need to happen. We're not going to solve childhood sexual abuse in the Catholic Church or in the United Nations or in corporate America. We're not going to solve that with one thing. We're going to be circling around it, doing lots of different things that help support the victims, that help get a better, tighter grip on what's really happening, more justice, more healing, more prevention. And you're going to do it wrong some of the time. You know, you're going to have conversations with people where you go, I didn't mean, oh, I hurt your feelings. That didn't work. I'm sorry. Then you go back to it. You don't freak out when it doesn't work the first time. You know, just get it in your mind that this is how it's going to be. But whatever you choose, whether you choose to advocate, support, or educate, understand you are part of something big and beautiful. You are part of the movement to reclaim society, to defend the family, and to build a civilization of love. Thank you very much.
The Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution is a one-of-a-kind annual event created by the Ruth Institute to empower individuals and families harmed by divorce, the hookup culture, and other forms of family breakdown. Every year we bring activists, experts, and victims together to understand the damage the sexual revolution has caused. Subscribe for weekly videos or visit our website for more details. Thank you for watching.